Welcome to Ardsley United Methodist Church. Welcome to our Sunday morning worship. And this Sunday is Sunday, September 5th. So we'll also be having Holy Communion. Our opening hymn this morning is Jesus is all the world to me. Please join us in the call to worship printed here in the bulletin.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Holy God, you not only comfort us, but you also challenge us. Your word awakes us to love justice.
Lord, make us whole and keep us honest.
Holy God, you bring justice to those who are marginalized. In our community, help us to be advocates of what is right.
Lord, make us whole and keep us honest.
May our worship this morning flow into our actions, our pocketbooks, our attitudes, and our relationships.
Lord, make us whole and keep us honest.
People of God, with what shall we come before the Holy One and bow ourselves before the Lord on high?
God has shown,
us what is good.
What does the
Holy One require of us but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with our God?
With the prophet Amos, let us proclaim our hope for the world.
Justice shall roll on like a river, and righteousness like a never-failing stream. Amen.
Amen. Please pray with me. We pray for acceptance and understanding, Lord. If I have no feet, let me journey with my eyes. If I have no sight, let me view with my mind. If I have no hearing, let me listen with my heart. If I have no speech, let me talk with a touch. If I have no hands, let me hold you in my thoughts. And if I have no control, let me be calm and at peace in your grace. Let me use what I do have to bless, accept, and understand others. Dear Lord, we all need assistance. Whether I need a wheelchair, a cane, a hearing aid, a guide, a visual aid, or a computer, allow me to show what I can do and model for others. Acceptance, ability, and thanks, and to follow you in all that I do. Amen.
Our first reading is from Hebrews, Psalm 125. Those who trust in the Lord are like Mount Zion, which cannot be moved, but abides forever. As the mountains surround Jerusalem, so the Lord surrounds his people, from this time on and forevermore. For the scepter of the wickedness shall not rest on the land allotted to the righteous, but that the righteous might not stretch out their hands to do wrong. Do good, O Lord, to those who are good, and to those who are upright in their heart. But those who turn aside to their own crooked ways, the Lord will lead away with evildoers. Peace be upon Israel. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Thanks be to God. We will now have children's time with Alana.
Good morning. Hi, Charlotte. How are you?
Good.
Good. Nice. So today we're going to be talking about healing, feeling better. And oh, we have another friend with us. Who's that?
He's a cute little fox.
Oh, it's a cute fox. Oh, it's cute.
And I got him yesterday.
Aw. He looks so cuddly. So Charlotte, was there ever a time when you needed to feel better? Like maybe you got a boo-boo, a scrape, or a paper cut?
Maybe. Yes.
Yeah. All right. How did it get better? Did anybody help you?
My mom kept putting band-aids on it.
Oh, good. She got you band-aids. Yeah. And that's nice of her. Oh, yeah. You still have a boo-boo?
Yes. I got off a scooter and it was bleeding bad.
It's getting better though?
Yes.
Good. So one of the best ways to feel better, you know, which can be like a band-aid of some sort, but maybe a band-aid you can't see, would be through prayer. And today in our gospel reading, which we're gonna hear before Pastor Calvin's gonna preach, Jesus, he healed many people. And they have some bigger things that need healing, like maybe people who couldn't see or they can't hear, or they couldn't even walk. Imagine that. And he did amazing things to heal those people from those different things. And he wanted to have everybody included in his life and throughout his ministry too. So we can always count on Jesus to help with our boo-boos by prayer. All right, we're going to pray together, okay? Thank you, God, for healing in prayer. Thank you for answering our prayers and for healing in ways that only you can do. Amen.
Can you say goodbye?
Goodbye.
Thank you for coming to church. See you.
The Gospel of Mark, chapter 7, verses 24 through 37. From there he set out and went away to the region of Tyre. He entered a house and did not want anyone to know he was there. Yet he could not escape notice. But a woman whose little daughter had an unclean spirit immediately heard about him, and she came down and bowed down at his feet. Now the woman was a Gentile of Syrophoenician origin. She begged him to cast the demon out of her daughter. He said to her, "Let the children be fed first, for it is not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs." But she answered him, "Sir, even the dogs under the table eat the children's crumbs." Then he said to her, "For saying that, you may go. The demon has left your daughter." So she went home and found the child lying on the bed and the demon gone. Then he returned from the region of Tyre and went by way of Sidon towards the Sea of Galilee in the region of Decapolis. They brought to him a deaf man who had an impediment in his speech, and they begged him to lay his hand on him. He took him aside in private, away from the crowd, and put his fingers into his ears, and he spat and touched his tongue. Then, looking up to heaven, he sighed and said to him, "Ephphatha," that is, "be opened." And immediately his ears were open, his tongue was released, and he spoke plainly. For your presence this day. Help us make space for everyone, to make the welcome wide for all your children. Speak through me and in spite of me, for I am a vessel of your word and your will. Amen. We are called to be Jesus to the world. Growing up, I sang in many churches throughout the summer, and one of the songs that I would sing was called "Jesus to the World." It shares many thoughts, but one that has stuck with me throughout all this time is the phrase, "We can talk and talk about what is wrong, but that won't change one thing at all when we take God's love where the hurting live, because that's what Jesus did." Friends, it is in our DNA as United Methodists to care for those that are hurting, those marginalized, and those that the world perceives as the other. It is in our DNA as United Methodists to take into the world this hope and to change things, at least to try to change things, because sometimes change might not happen, but we can take a step towards change, and that is better than standing still or going backwards. Not just keeps things the same, but with divine guidance, make the world a better place. It is not just one or two of us that are called. Because one or two of us can do some good, but when everyone is together, coming together as a people, we can share in God's love to the world in so many ways. We do so much more when we work together. We need, the world needs us to be Jesus to the world. We need to not go up to others with preconceived notions, especially if they're different than us. I have to say, it's a hard thing to do. We always love to people watch, especially if we're sitting in a car and someone is driving past us or walking, and we think things about that person. But it's not what Jesus would have done in that situation. It's what Jesus would do when we call to others and say, "How are you? I'm glad you're here. I'm glad you exist. And I'm glad that you are present in this space together. Let's not just talk and talk and talk some more without the walk, without doing the walk. We must put our faith into action. We must put our faith into what holds the future for this beloved community of faith. Today's gospel lesson from Mark leaves us stunned and amazed. For those around Jesus, to see these miracles happening is truly spectacular and life-changing. He healed the sick, caused those who could not possibly take any steps to walk, maybe even run. He called those who did not have sight to see clearly and use mud to do it. How amazing is that? And today in this gospel lesson, he gave hearing to someone that could not hear and touched the tongue so someone could speak that was not possible to speak. How truly amazing is that? And truly significant and beautiful to see the way Jesus interacted with those who had difficulty, with those who had disabilities. Maybe in that story, looking at Mary and Martha, we remember that story of when Jesus came to Mary and Martha's and Lazarus' house. Lazarus, who Jesus wept over his death. Maybe it's possible that Lazarus had a learning difficulty. Former Archbishop of Canterbury, Justin Welby, presents an idea that Lazarus did not speak, nor did he live alone. He lived with his sisters, Mary and Martha. Well, that is if you take that story as face value. He shares that Jesus sees in Lazarus something extraordinarily special. His humanity, his being made in the image of God. In Lazarus, Jesus sees someone whom it is worth risking his life for. Let me repeat that. In Lazarus, Jesus sees someone for whom it is worth risking his life for. He shares this excerpt from the text that he wrote about this. I've always had a love for the story. You know, I've always had a love for the story of Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. I think there is a lot to be gained when we think deeply about this text and how the lives of each person in this text were changed through each other's life and the actions of each. Here's a refresher of that story. Now, as they went on their way, he entered a certain village where a woman named Martha welcomed him in her home. She had a sister named Mary who sat at the Lord's feet and listened to what he was saying. But Martha was distracted by her many tasks, so she came to him and asked, "Lord, do you not care that I am here and my sister has left me to do all the work by myself? Tell her then to help me." But the Lord answered, "Martha, Martha, you are worried and distracted by many things. There is need of one thing. Mary has chosen the better part, which will not be taken away from her." So, Martha was working on providing a wide welcome for Jesus, where she was bothered about Mary listening so intently and not helping her. We don't even hear about Lazarus in this one, but he's still present. Maybe he was with Mary listening intently to Jesus every word, or possibly he was helping Martha in the kitchen, which would have given pause to the idea that Mary was just listening intently while the others were busy providing hospitality in a physical way. Going back to this passage from the Gospel of Mark, it is one of the driving forces in the call of inclusion for everyone, especially those with disabilities. It is important to know what Jesus did, accomplished, and set into existence to understand the importance of those around Jesus. The miracles, the amazing things Jesus was able to accomplish are truly magnificent. There's no different word. There's no better word than magnificent. We cannot think that they are just stories, just allegory, but when we consider the depth of those who went the extra distance to get to Jesus, those who lowered someone through a roof, who took a chance and touched the cloak of Jesus, it puts things into perspective on who this man called Jesus is and what he was capable of doing. We don't read about all of the miracles of Jesus, but the ones we do have in the Bible, in the New Testament, set into the important realization that people with disabilities really were of a specific importance in the work of Christ. It is in that importance that we receive the call of providing accessibility in many ways, not just accessible spaces, but accessible worship as well. If there are those who have hearing difficulty, maybe they are difficult in seeing or in walking, it is providing in the midst of those accessibility differences. It cannot just be a pie in the sky idea, We can't just keep going without doing something. We have to put into action the call of accessibility. We have to take these steps and to take chances, much like those who reached Jesus in so many ways and those who interacted with Jesus when he took chances himself. What chances are you taking? What chances have you not taken, but you wish you would? What chances do you feel the Spirit is leading you to take? Let's just take a moment, 10 seconds, and write down one chance that you're going to take this week in your life, in your faith journey. One of the first documents that was sent to me from this church was its charge conference report. I noticed the accessibility audit and read through it, and there are things that I would love to see happen. It is my prayer that this space, this beautiful community of faith, not just in its physical building, but in its spiritual sense as well, in the community sense, can become truly accessible for everyone, no matter what it takes. It is worth it, friends. It is a joy to see that you have already started this work by installing the lift to be able to provide access to those that need it. I shared with you part of my dream in my previous message on accessibility, but today I believe that I have a call from the Spirit, from the heart, to create truly an accessible space. It is a call to accessibility. I pray that as we go forward from this space, that we might think of those with disabilities and how we can include them and be in worship with them. Not worship to, but worship with. There's a difference. One of the greatest ways of accessibility is through the sacrament of Holy Communion. It is not only visual, not only kinesthetic, but it is not only hearing, but it touches all the senses. Holy Communion is one of the most beautiful moments in life. It is a truly accessible moment in life. Not only the accessibility of the physical experience, but the accessibility when we think of those who are less, that the world perceives as less. Maybe they have less money. Maybe they don't have the best clothes. But friends, Holy Communion is likely one of the only times where everyone is equal. I share that because it's an important realization that when we come to this table, we receive the same gifts as everyone else. It does not matter our status in the world. It does not matter how much we have or how much we give, but we receive the same body and blood of Jesus Christ. That's what is so amazing about this special time that we share in. It is such a beautiful moment. It is truly accessible for everyone. I've experienced so many times when people could not come forward, but someone, likely the person holding the elements, would take the gifts of the body and blood of Jesus to them. Whether it be in their seat in worship, their home, hospital, care facility, or rehabilitation center. Maybe, just maybe, we can take Jesus and the actions of Christ, our witness, to these places as well. Not just take them communion, but take us together as a community. Maybe it's reaching out to someone that they might not seem like they're like us. Maybe they might not even seem like they've ever come to church. But friends, they matter. They're valued and they're a beloved child of God. Maybe they're the next person that's called into ministry. Because friends, God does not make mistakes, and God's call rests on anyone, not just the people that we perceive are called, but anyone who God has called into ministry. Can I get an amen in here? When we share in this sacrament in just a few moments, let us pray that God will lead us to those spaces. Maybe they're uncomfortable for us. Maybe they're not even accessible spaces right now. But those that are important for our journey and life, those that we can make a difference and make accessible, those that we can make comfortable, those that we can make welcoming, those that we can make including, those that God has laid their hand upon and breathed life through the Spirit, we can do this work together. It will take some time and it will take some resources, but this world, this community, this place will be more accessible because of it. Our worship will be more accessible because of it, and the call that rests on our heart will be forwarded in this divine work. I believe this church is capable of this call to do this, and that we are in the right place to do this work. It's a big task. It's a large commitment. It's an uncomfortable commitment, but it's an important one. As we come to the table, be prepared that God might just change your life through your willingness and faith in what is possible and what God is calling you to do. Amen. Let us pray. God, as we come to this time of Holy Communion in just a few moments, may it be a turning point. May it be a stepping stone towards accessibility. May it be a turning point towards inclusion. May it be a turning point towards a more Spirit-filled, Spirit-led church. God, we get so much from this sacrament, and we thank you for your presence that changes us, that guides us, and that is guiding us towards the future in our work and ministry. The Gospel of Mark, chapter 7.
Your financial support is generously appreciated and used to forward this call to give ideas towards the future, to do this work, this important work, as we work to be more accessible, as we work to be more inclusive. Let us now give to God a portion of what has been so graciously given to us. Let us pray. God, we give you thanks for the gifts that have been given. We give you thanks for the generosity of this community of faith in many ways. I pray that you would use these gifts to forward this work, that you would multiply these gifts in ways that only you can, and that we would be good stewards, that we would be great stewards of the financial blessings of this congregation. May it be so. Amen.
Amen.
Let us pray. Holy God, loving Maker, divine embrace, we are present, and we invite you to be present with us. As we invite you, we must think of those that have not been invited to the table. Those who have only gotten up the crumbs of pieces of food under the table. We lament the harm that the church has caused to people whom you call beloved. Help us do better. Lead us to do better. Divine embrace, we confess that most of the time it's about us and not about those whom we should see. Too many times we put our blinders on when you nudge us to help, when you urge us to assist, when you say, go say hi to that person, tell them they're loved. We need your guidance and we ask you to lead us. We pray for those that we are able to reach and those that we have neglected to reach. Help us do better. Lead us, God. We ask that you would forgive those sins that we so often take part in. We pray for the sin of not loving our neighbor, and we pray that you would help us do better. Lead us, God. We pray for a fire within us to allow us to see the people and to care for everyone that you put in our path. We thank you for your grace and your abundant love that still values each individually and together as your beloved. Lead us to the next place, the next person, the next spiritual journey. All this we ask in the presence of Christ, the guiding light to so many. Amen. God is with us always. But we just want to take a moment to ask the Spirit to be present and to welcome home God into God's house. Let's give God some praise and some glory to God, our Creator, the one who has caused us to be present today, the one who woke us up this morning, the one who calls us in the midst of so much turmoil and calls us beloved. God is with us. God be with you on your journey. And with you on yours. Lift up your hearts to God. We lift them up to God, our guiding compass. Let us give thanks, praise, honor, glory to God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is. It is. So many times we forget, though. So many times we find ourselves so busy that we forget to thank you, God. We forget to acknowledge your presence. Help us to slow down and give thanks. Help us to reflect on the amazing blessings that you have poured out upon us. It is with grateful and joyful hearts that we join our voices, gathered virtually in this space, joining with the heavenly host, proclaiming your greatness and hospitable love. So we honor you and sing to you this song of praise.
Holy, holy, holy is our Lord, God of all.
go on singing your praises. We want to just take a moment to reflect, to remember the amazing acts that your son, Jesus, did throughout the world. Those places where you guided him and where he guided others, where he included others when many were excluded by the people that thought they were doing the right thing. We remember how he knelt down, taking the lowest possible position, maybe as Mary, like Mary washed Jesus' feet with the oil from that alabaster jar. He washed the feet, the smelly, dirty, unclean feet of his friends and those that he knew would betray him. We give thanks for his radical hospitality that calls us to wash the feet of our neighbors. Lead us, God, to those places where we can serve our neighbor. We remember how Jesus at the table, maybe the table had splinters, maybe the table had a wobbly leg, but it was perfect for a king. Perfect for the son of the ruler of the universe to lift up some bread and say, "Take, for this is my body which is given for you. Whenever you eat of this bread, take in remembrance of me." Lead us, God, to those neighbors that are hungry for you and for physical nourishment as well. We remember how Jesus was sitting on a chair, maybe even on the dusty floor, how he took a cup, a simple cup, the cup that was possibly broken and mended, similar to our lives, and he took and lifted it, and it was perfect for the son of the ruler of the universe. Perfect for a king to lift it up and say, to drink from this cup, for this is my blood of the new covenant that is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink of this cup, drink in remembrance of me. Lead us, God, to those neighbors that are thirsty spiritually. Maybe they're physically thirsty as well. And help us to provide places where we see and where we can serve our neighbor. In the midst of the mystery of this time together, of this meal, and the mystery of the world, we proclaim together this holy mystery of our faith that keeps us going on the journey.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We receive wonder,
that you would do truly something amazing and filled with wonder by pouring out your Holy Spirit on all of those gathered wherever they are, and to to go and to serve our neighbors, and that you would pour your spirit on these gifts of bread and wine, that you would transform them into the body and blood of Christ, so that we may be the body of Christ, redeemed by the blood of Christ. Lead us until Christ comes in final victory, and we feast at his heavenly banquet. All this we ask in the name of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray this prayer for our journey. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, the body of Christ, for the body of Christ, take in remembrance that Christ gave his life for you, and be thankful. The blood of Christ for you, the body of Christ. Take in remembrance that Christ gave his life for you, and be thankful. In the United Methodist Church, we practice an open table. All are welcome, no matter who you are, no exceptions. Welcome to this holy feast where Christ is the host. Come, eat, drink, and be changed. I invite you now to take these gifts of the body and blood of Jesus Christ. The body of Christ, the bread of heaven. The blood of Christ, the cup of salvation. Whenever you eat of this bread and drink of this cup, do this in remembrance of Jesus, that gave his life for you, and be thankful. Take now these gifts as you feel led by the Spirit.
Thank you.
Let us pray. God, we just experienced some of the world's amazing wonders, some of the most powerful experiences that we can even fathom. We can't even fathom the glory, the joy, the power, your presence in this meal, in this time together. We pray that you would send us to be the church that the world needs to hear, that they're loved, that they're valued, and to embrace everyone that comes our way. We pray that you would pour your Holy Spirit into this church, that you would send your fire upon all of those gathered and those that will gather in the future. We pray for an abundance, for an increase in so many ways. And we don't just pray for it to help financially, but we pray for it because we want to do more for the community. We want to do so many more things that can help us to spread the love of Christ, to share in this transformative work by taking these gifts that we receive in this time into the world to proclaim your love. Help us to do that work. Lead us where you call us to be. All this we ask in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let us pray.
May you go from the table, from this place, in peace. May you find hope in what is to come. May you find your call in what God is leading you to do and do some amazing things with that call. May the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit bless, preserve, and keep you now and forevermore. Amen. Sing with us our closing hymn, followed by the postlude.
Thank you.
peace.